Bobcats are very secretive animals, and they travel mostly at night. And we haven't had a study in South Dakota before, and so we're mainly trying to get information on home ranges, movements, habitat use, and mortality.
It sounds real interesting. Why would the Bad River be selected as a bobcat study area?
Well, the Bad River is representative of several rivers in western South Dakota that run east and west, and they drain into the Missouri River. And a lot of the bobcats that are taken by trappers are taken in this habitat type, so we picked one to be representative of that habitat.
But John, you're the guy in the trenches. You're the guy out here working in it every day. What's an average day like for you?
Well, I go out in the field, and I basically these cats have collars on them, and each collar has a certain frequency, and I go out and I track these cats, and when I pick up a frequency, I may go in and scare up that cat and see where it's at that day, time of the day, and I basically cover type all the river system, which is about a 60-mile stretch, and we basically plot all these fixes, and that'll help us determine what the home ranges are and what the overlap is and what type of habitat these cats are in during certain times of the day.
Now, bobcats prefer fairly secluded habitat areas. So when John goes out looking for these bobcats, he's going along stretches of the Bad River, looking for wet, muddy areas where he can find bobcat tracks. Now, in order to catch these cats to radio collar them, he uses two types of traps. One is the large and bulky cage trap. Now, this live trap here is really tough to get a cat to go in there, but the door can be propped open and bait placed inside. Now, John would also camouflage this with sticks, and the cat would go in to work the bait, the door would fall and hold him there for John to come through. Another way is with a padded leg hold trap. Now, this trap has rubber jaws, and it's placed in the ground on a trail or somewhere where the bobcat will pass by. There may or may not be bait placed nearby, but when the cat is caught in this trap, he doesn't go far, he's unharmed, and John comes through every day to check his traps. He's got a cat, he can tranquilize him, and then get the radio collar put on.
As you can see right here, this is the receiver. This is how I pick up these cats with the transmitters. Each collar has a different frequency, and that helps me determine which cat it is. I also have these cats named to help me out a little bit, so I don't have to remember the numbers all the time. It's hooked up to this here, and it goes through the roof, and this is a compass rose. This is actually tells me where the cat is by using a 0 to 360-degree grid, and I can rotate this freely as I'm tracking on the highway, and I plot a number down, say it's like 230, and then I go out like another mile of a different direction and pick up another signal and say it's 300. Wherever these two cross, that tells me where the cat is. And then I can plot all these on aerial maps at home in my office.
All of John's trapped cats are administered a tranquilizer drug, weighed, and run through a series of measurements to determine age. This particular cat's radio collar was replaced and blood was drawn before his release. Valuable information is obtained from each bobcat, information which is fed into a computer model to aid the biologists in estimating population densities as well as important facts on the bobcat's preferences to habitat, food, and their relationships with other bobcats. As this four-year study concludes, you can bet South Dakota will have a much better idea of how to manage their delicate population of bobcats.